Welcome, Dr. Epic here. And in this lecture, we're going to learn about a raccoon in a tree. We're going to discuss dueling national anthems and study scalawags, sunken ships, repeating rifles, and who will care for Mother now when this cruel war is over. We're going to follow that outline right up above my head as we study the turning of the American Civil War. And all of this information is in service to a single historical question that you should be building an answer for. Was the American Civil War the final triumph of liberty over slavery or a national tragedy of a failed political and economic system? Examine the outbreak and conduct of the war from one of these two perspectives. Was the war inevitable? Could Lincoln have won without resorting to total war? Was all of the death and destruction visited on the South justified? And does the messy post-war period change your perspective? It is the end of 1862 and the beginning of 1863, and the United States is losing the American Civil War. The Union Army of the Potomac has been savaged 5 times by Robert E. Lee and the Army of Northern Virginia. The Union Army of the Tennessee is locked in a deadly stalemate with the Confederate Army of Tennessee in the mountains and valleys of the Southern Appalachians. Only in the West are there some glimmers of hope as a few regiments make progress along the Mississippi River, but they're drawing closer to what is supposed to be an impregnable Confederate stronghold called Vicksburg. Abraham Lincoln is worried, and Abraham Lincoln should be worried for 2 very important reasons. One, as you can see from this cartoon, the British are getting ready to recognize the Confederacy. Here we have a British cartoon of the day, which shows Abraham Lincoln as a treed raccoon. And below him is John Bull, the symbol of the British Empire. And he's getting ready to pull the trigger on that shotgun, blowing President Lincoln right out of that tree. And that's how the British are viewing the situation. All they have to do is recognize the Confederacy and enter the war on the side of the Confederacy. And the war is over and the United States has been split in two. All they have to do is pull that trigger. And the other reason that Abraham Lincoln should be absolutely worried is that there is a building peace movement in the North. There is a movement in the North that has convinced itself that Lincoln cannot win the war, and the North should simply make peace as best it can. Because what's happened is those old doughfaces, the Northern people who loved the South, have turned into copperheads. That's what they call them in the 19th century. Copperheads, untrustworthy traitors. And the king of the copperheads is George McClellan, the general that lost to Lincoln in the Peninsular Campaign. And you can see from the campaign materials right above my head, there is the Democratic ticket. Elect McClellan and the whole Democratic ticket for an honorable, permanent, and happy peace. And they will ensure peace with the South, and they will defeat Negro equality. And according to the Democrats, if you elect Lincoln and the Republicans, that is a blow for racial equality, and we can't be having that. So Lincoln is very worried about the election that's coming up in 1864. And he's so worried, he decides to swap out his vice president. Harry Hamblin was the president that was elected with him in 1861. And he decides to swap this guy out with Andrew Johnson. And Andrew Johnson is this really kind of funny character himself. He's a senator from Tennessee, which is interesting because Tennessee joined the Confederacy. So he refused to give up his seat and became a Unionist. But he is extremely sympathetic towards the Confederates, and he can sway a lot of Democratic votes in border states. And that's why Lincoln puts him on the ticket. But there's still the problem of the British as they get ready to recognize the Confederacy. To forestall a British recognition of the Confederate States of America, Abraham Lincoln sits down with his cabinet and starts talking about ways they can get allies in Britain. And an idea that's been floating around for quite a while is to issue some kind of emancipation proclamation to free the slaves, but to do so in a way that's not going to cost Abraham Lincoln the election in 1864. So they work out this very careful Emancipation Proclamation, and they issue it on January 1st, 1863. And the Emancipation Proclamation says that all the slaves are free, but only in the unconquered portions of the Confederacy. The Emancipation Proclamation does not actually free that many slaves. It doesn't free the slaves in the slave states that never joined the Confederacy, like Maryland or Kentucky or Missouri, and it can't free the slaves in the parts of the Confederacy that the Confederacy control, and it doesn't even free the slaves in the parts of the Confederacy that have been conquered by the U.S. Army. So it actually frees not a whole lot of people, but it is a statement that as the Union armies move forward and liberate different parts of the Confederacy, the slaves there will be freed as the American armies advance. And again, this is primarily to forestall a British recognition of the Confederacy, because there is a strong abolitionist sentiment in Great Britain. And this is what you see in another British cartoon right up above my head called John Bull Makes a Discovery. John Bull, of course, the symbol of the British Empire, is suddenly shocked to discover that all of this cotton that he's been importing and making into clothes and all these textile mills has been picked by African-American slaves. Oh my goodness, they're shocked to the core. Because the abolitionists in England start to heavily criticize their own politicians. How dare you even suggest that we recognize the Confederacy? After all, we know that the Union, Abraham Lincoln, is fighting to free the slaves. We know this because of the Emancipation Proclamation. However, the Emancipation Proclamation does more than just forestall a British entry into the war. What it does, and we don't know whether this was intended or not, what it does is it starts to turn the war into something very different. The Civil War begins to turn from a war to preserve the Union into a crusade to free the slaves. And the U.S. Army embraces this religious iconography. It embraces this religious mission. And over again, they start talking about, why are we fighting this war? We're fighting this war to free our fellow Americans. This is something easy that soldiers can get behind. This is a crusade, a religious crusade, a holy war to free the slaves. And this can be seen in the songs that they begin to sing in the army. Most notably, the Battle Hymn of the Republic. Now, I'm not gonna sing the Battle Hymn of the Republic. My singing voice is simply too terrible, but I am going to read you the lyrics from the first part of the song, and I want you to listen to what this might mean for, like, your common soldier in a Civil War army. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. I have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. I have read a fiery gospel writ in burnished rows of steel. As ye deal with my condemners, so with you my grace shall feel. Let the hero born of woman crush the serpent with his heel, since God is marching on. He has sounded forth the trumpet that will never call retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make them free, while God is marching on. I mean, this seems like such a weird thing from a 21st century perspective, but the army begins to sing religious hymns as they march into battle. The religious nature that comes out of the Emancipation Proclamation is infectious, and many soldiers start to think, this is why we're fighting. We're fighting to free our fellow Americans. We are fighting to make men free. And one of the real ironies is, Battle Hymn of the Republic, the lyrics were written during the Civil War, but the music itself is much, much older. And in fact, the tune, you know, the tune itself was actually written in the South. And to make, this is like one of those, like, you know, innumerable Civil War ironies, the national anthem of the Confederacy, you know, Dixie, That song is actually written in Ohio. So kind of the national anthems of the war, the song for the North was written in the South, and the anthem in the South was written in the North. But Lincoln finds a general that can win battles, and that guy's name is Ulysses S. Grant, also called Sam Grant. Now, Sam Grant did not have a very distinguished career. He fought in the Mexican War. He wasn't particularly distinguished. He didn't particularly like the war. He didn't like the army. He's a failed shopkeeper, but he answers the call of his country when the Civil War erupts. But he doesn't have the political connections. He doesn't have the talent to end up in the Army of the Potomac, where all the really ambitious people went. He ends up in the western part of the Army of Tennessee, as you know, where basically all the screw-ups and rejects ended up, because it's not a glamorous part of the army. And that's where Ulysses S. Grant meets with his old friend, William Tecumseh Sherman. That's him in the lower left corner. And both of these men had a very troubled history. Grant was a recovering alcoholic, or semi-recovering alcoholic, and William Sherman was insane. He was obsessive, compulsive, paranoid. In fact, many years later, Sherman would say, Grant helped me when I was crazy, and I helped him when he was drunk. But the thing is, together, these guys can really win battles. And they start to win these little battles at first. You know, Ulysses S. Grant and Tecumseh Sherman are together. They fight this battle called the Siege of Fort Henry on February 6, 1862. And it's a very unglamorous battle. They roll up, they dig trenches, they bring up the heavy artillery, and they just start bombing this Confederate force into pieces. And the broken and shattered Confederates come out. They want to discuss terms of surrender. And Ulysses S. Grant is like, no, unconditional terms of surrender. You're just going to surrender and hope I just don't shoot every one of you traitors in the head. And the Confederates are completely shocked. They're like, we're not going to accept those terms of surrender. And Sam Grant's like, all right, go back in your fort and we start bombing again in 15 minutes. The Confederates surrender. Sam Grant moves his division south and slams into the Confederates at the Battle of Donelson, which lasts for 6 days in 1862. And again, it's this very workmanlike battle. Ulysses S. Grant rolls his forces up, he digs trenches, he brings up the heavy artillery, and just starts bombing and blasting the Confederates, you know, into next week. And the Confederates in Donelson are completely stunned. They just can't do anything against Ulysses S. Grant. Do they attack his men in the trenches? No, they're backed by cannon. That would be suicide. And eventually the commander comes out and says, well, what are your terms of surrender, you know, Ulysses Grant? And Sam Grant goes, unconditional surrender. Again, just surrender and hope I just don't shoot and execute all of you traitors in the next 10 minutes. And the Confederate general absolutely refuses. This is absolutely unacceptable. He goes back into Donelson, and Ulysses S. Grant waits about half an hour, fires up the heavy artillery again. And they start blasting the Confederates left and right until the Confederates are finally forced into a humiliating surrender. And again, here's yet another Civil War irony. That general that surrenders to Ulysses S. Grant is none other than John Floyd, James Buchanan's Secretary of War, the guy that sent, you know, 100,000 rifled muskets to the Confederates. And Ulysses S. Grant, as he's making gains in Tennessee, he starts to alarm the Confederates, and they're like, we've got to take this guy out. So they assemble this Confederate army, and they throw it at him, and this meets at the Battle of Shiloh. And the Battle of Shiloh is a bloodbath. It's a complete bloodbath. Grant is completely unprepared for the Confederate attack. There's a rumor that he's drunk at the time, and the Confederates attack on April 6th and make incredible gains. They overrun the Union camp. They burn his spare ammunition, and he's about to lose, and any other general at this point would simply retreat and declare that he's lost the battle. But this just angers Ulysses S. Grant. And on April 7th, he rallies together his shattered army and does something the Confederates did not expect. He counterattacks with a broken and shattered force. And that overruns the Confederates. And in this second day of tremendous blood-filled fighting, he actually pushes the Confederates back. Ulysses S. Grant doesn't care about how many casualties he takes on that second day of Shiloh. He is going to win this battle. And he does. He forces the Confederates back, and he begins to chase the Confederates down the Mississippi River as towards Vicksburg. And Grant's conduct at the Battle of Shiloh alarms a lot of people back in Washington. Some of the senior generals approach Abraham Lincoln, and they say, this guy's a lot of trouble. He was drunk. That's the rumor, that he was drunk. You got to get rid of him. And Abraham Lincoln says, I cannot spare him. He wins battles. There's also an apocryphal story in which they reply to him saying, that Grant, he's a drunk. All he does is drink whiskey. And Abraham Lincoln is supposed to have replied, tell me what brand it is and I'll send a barrel to each of the other generals. But Abraham Lincoln didn't actually say that. There's probably just a bit of apocrypha from the Civil War. But Grant wins battles. Grant wins battles, you know, and this is another one of the other charges against Grant. Grant wins battles over battlefields littered with Union dead. Grant does not care about casualties, and he gets a reputation as a butcher. But he does win battles. And Grant and Sherman meet with Abraham Lincoln, and they decide how we're going to fight this war. And Grant and Sherman devise an entirely new way to win this war. Both Grant and Sherman propose total war. We need to make total war on the Confederates. Now, what is total war? Total war is when you don't fight an enemy's army. You don't attempt to degrade an enemy's military over some river valley or mountain ridge. Total war is when you make war on an enemy nation. And your goal is not to break their military, but to shatter the nation itself. Grant says, look, it's not enough to just merely defeat the Confederates. You must break them. You must humiliate them. This is why he insisted on unconditional surrender. So there would be no doubt you have been beaten, you have been defeated, and if you leave at all, you should be utterly disgraced. And Lincoln likes what he hears, because this is a winning strategy, that as these armies move forward, they're not just going to meet the Confederates and beat the Confederates. They're going to move into Confederate territory. They're going to burn bridges. They're going to burn houses. They're going to shoot cattle. They're going to butcher hogs. They're going to rip up railroads. They're going to blow up bridges. They're going to destroy everything that the Confederates can use to make war, because they're going to break the Confederate nation. But to do that on a really massive scale, to push the Confederates back and tear their nation apart, that's going to require a lot more soldiers, especially given the way that Grant spends bodies. Hundreds of thousands of more soldiers are going to be needed to do this. Lincoln begins to vastly enlarge the size of the Union Army. How many soldiers will you need, Grant? And Grant casually goes, maybe a million and a half. So Lincoln starts to find these million soldiers. And he finds a bunch of them in the South. Over 100,000 Southerners head north to serve in the Union Army. These are the Unionists. Now, after the war, these guys, their reputations are going to be ruined for the rest of their lives. They return to the South and they're known as traitors. They're known as murderers. But the most common term applied to them is the slur scalawag. They are socially ostracized. They are considered traitors to the people of their own home states. And one of the more prominent scalawags is Edmund Davis. Edmund Davis is a rancher. He's a judge down in Galveston. He heads north to fight for Lincoln and eventually ends up being the general of the 1st Texas Cavalry. But the 1st Texas Cavalry is fighting for the federal government. Let's return to our ethical dilemma. Put yourself in Edmund Davis's shoes. Your home and your family are in rebellion against the federal government. What do you do? Do you side with your family and with your state because you know them and they're their friends and you're related to them, even though they're fighting for an immoral cause, which is the defense of American slavery? Or do you fight for your country against your friends and family, but you're fighting for something that's good, the Emancipation Proclamation, the destruction of American slavery. And I don't want an answer, but I want you to roll this ethical dilemma around in your head. Did Edmund Davis, in making war against his own home state, against his own home, against his own friends and family, did he make the morally correct decision? What do you do if you're a Southerner? Do you fight for your country or do you fight for your family? 100,000 Southerners head north to fight for their country. Abraham Lincoln throws open the gates to Ireland. Ireland is still reeling from the effects of the potato famine in the 1840s and 50s, and there are hundreds of thousands of Irish willing to come to the United States. And Lincoln lets them into the country in exchange for military service. Over 150,000 Irish immigrants cross the Atlantic to serve in the Union Army in exchange for citizenship. You can see in the illustration right up above, they're wearing Union uniforms, flying American flags, and then flying the green flag with the golden harp, the flag of Ireland. And they formed Irish regiment after Irish regiment, fighting for a country that they might not have ever known before they crossed the ocean. A lot of Irish fight for Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln introduces the draft. Up until now, the Union Army had been filled with volunteers, but not after 1863. He institutes the Draft Act of 1863, and they institute these draft wheels in all of the counties of the North. And the way it would work is they would simply say, this county is going to provide X number of men, 500 or 700 or 2,000 men. And every man in the county gets issued a number, and each of those numbers is written on a ball, and they put the balls in the draft wheel, and they spin the wheel, and then they take out the number of balls equal to the men who have to be drafted. And if your number comes up, you are going to serve your country. You're going to put on a blue hat, be handed a weapon, and told to go kill Johnny Reb. The draft is insanely unpopular. The draft fuels the Peace Party. It fuels the efforts of George McClellan. And one of the more unpopular aspects of the Draft Act of 1863 is that if your number comes up, you can pay to get out of military service. If you can pay $300 to the federal government, you don't have to serve, because Abraham Lincoln is also having problems funding the war. Or if you don't have $300, if you can get someone to serve for you for maybe $100 or $200, then you don't have to go into the army. In other words, the Draft Act of 1863 turns it into a fight between poor people. The draft only really applies to people who don't have $300. This is bitterly, bitterly resented, even though it is incredibly successful. Abraham Lincoln is going to draft somewhere around 750,000 Northerners. But it's not enough. It's still not enough soldiers. In 1863, Frederick Douglass, the famed abolitionist with the awesome hair, Frederick Douglass is literally walking down the street in Washington, D.C. He was in the city for other business. And he literally is sort of smoking a cigarette, walking in front of the White House, and he stares at the White House. And then shrugs and walks into the White House and says, I would like to speak to the president. And he's not expecting to get an actual meeting. What he expects is to be blown off and then maybe make an appointment for later. But somebody, he talks to somebody who talks to somebody who talks to somebody who talks to Abraham Lincoln. And Abraham Lincoln is like, Frederick Douglass is here? I'll speak with him right now. So literally Frederick Douglass walks in from off the street, and 15 minutes later, he's in the Oval Office talking to Abraham Lincoln. And Frederick Douglass says, I have an idea for you, Mr. President. And Abraham Lincoln as well, let's hear your idea. Frederick Douglass says, I can solve your manpower problem. I can solve your manpower problem tomorrow. And Abraham Lincoln says, how are you going to raise 100,000 men for me? Frederick Douglass says, arm the slaves. okay? Let African Americans join the army. And there's a bit of back and forth until finally Abraham Lincoln agrees. And they start forming African American units. And you can see the volunteer placards on the left. Men of color, to arms, now or never, 3 years service, battles of liberty and the Union. Fail now and our race is doomed. 200,000 African Americans join the army. Many after escaping slavery. People down in the Confederacy hear about the Emancipation Proclamation. They hear that African American units are being formed in the North. They will run away from the plantations, make their way north, find a Union unit, run up to it and say, I'm ready to serve Mr. Lincoln. And a month later, they're training in blue uniforms with blue hats. And that photograph right up above me is a very famous unit. That's the 54th Massachusetts. And if you ever see the movie Glory, it is all about those guys. And they took this picture and then they went off to war. And African-American soldiers performed magnificently in battle. You have a lot of very racist generals that said they only wanted them digging ditches or digging trenches or hauling wagons. But a few guys actually saw what African-Americans could do in battle and were incredibly impressed, particularly in the fights around North Carolina. Because you look at that photograph right up above my head, that photograph of the 54th Massachusetts, 3/4 of those men would be dead 6 months after this photograph was taken. They served with incredible valor and spectacular bravery. And one of the generals who really, really likes the idea of African Americans' uniform is Ulysses S. Grant. He finds the idea to be absolutely amazing, and he is not going to use black soldiers to dig trenches, dig latrines, or haul supplies. He is going to give them guns and put them into battle. In fact, he's going to give them the biggest guns he has. And here is a quote from Grant right up above my head. I am anxious to get as many of these Negro regiments as possible and to have them full and completely equipped. I am particularly desirous of organizing a regiment of heavy artillery from the Negroes to garrison this place and shall do so as soon as possible. And he meant what he said. And here is one of those heavy artillery units getting ready to attack Vicksburg. You can say a lot about Grant. You can call him a butcher. You can say he's a drunk. You can criticize his presidency later. But one of the things you can't really say about Grant is that he was a racist. Because Grant might have been many things, but unusual for the 19th century, Ulysses S. Grant was no racist. Let's go back to the map. And I want you to particularly look at the western part of the map. As Ulysses S. Grant, commanding the western section of the Army of the Tennessee, is moving down the Mississippi, nearing that great fortress of Vicksburg, where the Confederate Army of Mississippi has entrenched itself and created what they think is an impregnable fortress. The Gibraltar of the West is what they call it. And there's a map of the Siege of Vicksburg. You have the Confederate general, a guy called Pemberton, camped out in the middle of the city, and they dig trench lines all around the city, redoubts, shells all around the area, and the idea is that they can hold out forever inside this city and be resupplied by the river. Grant moves down, he marches around and around Vicksburg, he like burns the Mississippi State Capitol of Jackson at one point, and then he digs in around Vicksburg. And you can see that photograph right up above me. This is exactly the kind of fight that Grant is very, very good at. You dig trenches, you put observers, you send up observation balloons, you roll up your heavy artillery, and you start blasting. And inch by inch and day by day, you just tighten the vise on those defenders. And you just squeeze them and starve them and shoot them until you break that enemy army. This is the slow, steady, careful battle that Grant excels at. But the defenders of Vicksburg are supposed to get supplied by the river, but they don't know that there's a fleet moving down the river because the U.S. Navy has built this enormous riverine fleet of ironclad warships. And there they are right there. Right up above me, there's an image of the Navy, which has moved these ironclad warships underneath Vicksburg. And here they are blasting away at the defenses of Vicksburg while the Confederates blast down on them from the cliffs of Vicksburg, engaging in these long-distance artillery duels backwards and forwards. And there is a photograph of one of these ironclad riverine gunships. And these ships were belted with iron. So more often than not, the Confederate cannonballs would come down from Vicksburg and merely glance off the side of the vessel. And occasionally they would be able to sink one, but it was very rare. And the Confederates are looking at these iron ships, looking at their cannonballs and explosive shells bouncing off the sides of these ships. And they are now cut off from the land and the sea. Now, these are really weird warships, and over the passage of time, only a single warship has survived to the present day, or kind of a warship has survived to the present day, and that is the ruin of the USS Cairo. I have to be careful to pronounce it correctly. The Cairo was one of these riverine ironclads. Now, it was sunk by a mine in 1862, and it sank to the bottom of the Yazoo River, where it was buried in mud. But one of the things that the mud did is it preserved this warship for 100 years. And it was rediscovered in the 1950s, and plans in the 1970s were to recover it. And it was raised in 1977. They couldn't raise it all at once because of the mud. So they raised it piece by piece. There is a photograph of the Cairo during the Civil War, and if you go to the Vicksburg battlefield today, that is the remains of the Cairo, one of these riverine ironclads. You could actually walk inside the remains of that ship. It's absolutely incredible. It's the only Civil War ship that survives to the present day. Albeit it's in kind of rough shape, but you know, if I was 160 years old, I wouldn't look that good. Vicksburg is on the verge of falling. They've been besieged for 47 days. They can't escape. They're running out of food. They're eating rats. They're eating cats. They're boiling their shoes to make soup. The commander of Vicksburg, the Confederate guy named Pemberton, sends a message to the president of the Confederacy, Jefferson Davis, and he says, "We're going to fall. We're going to surrender. The Navy has closed off the river. Grant has surrounded me. He's squeezing the vise tighter every day. I'm running out of food. I'm running out of ammunition. Some of my cannons have run out of things to shoot. If you do not send relief, I will be forced to surrender." So Jefferson Davis turns to the only man that can save Vicksburg, Robert E. Lee. And he says, "Robert E. Lee, you've got to go save Vicksburg." And Robert E. Lee thinks about it and says, No, I don't really have to go. Because, you see, Robert E. Lee can look at a map. And Robert E. Lee says, even if we manage to save Vicksburg for now, we're going to be in the same situation in 6 to 8 months. Saving Vicksburg is not going to win us the war. The Emancipation Proclamation has stalled the British, but the British still want to help the Confederacy. They're still building warships. They're still smuggling arms and equipment into the Confederacy. Robert E. Lee looks at a map and says, the only way to really win this war is to win a big victory in the North, to invade the North, circle around Washington, and capture the capital city from the rear, or at least seal it off, and then trade Vicksburg for Washington, or maybe force Lincoln to come to terms about the separation of the Southern states. Robert E. Lee says, I'm not going to help Vicksburg. Or rather, the only way I can help Vicksburg is by invading the North, by betting everything on one huge gamble. And Jefferson Davis agrees to it. And Robert E. Lee gathers together the invincible Army of Northern Virginia and invades Pennsylvania. And you can see it. He attacks North in a single line, and it's his attempt, it's his goal to invade up through Pennsylvania, curve over, and come to Chesapeake Bay and get behind Washington, D.C., and then either take the city or force Lincoln to capitulate. The Army of the Potomac swings around to the North, and the two great armies meet at the Battle of Gettysburg. The Battle of Gettysburg is the largest battle in the Civil War. The Battle of Gettysburg is the largest, bloodiest battle in North America. In fact, the Battle of Gettysburg is the largest battle in the Western Hemisphere, ever fought in the Western Hemisphere. More than 100,000 soldiers clash outside this Pennsylvania town. The Union is defending a series of hills, a Cemetery Ridge, Little Round Top. And the Confederates attack over and over and over. It's a three-day battle. And Robert E. Lee has gambled everything on winning this battle. Again and again and again, the Confederates try to push the Army of the Potomac off the top of the hill. And again and again and again, they're pushed back until finally on the last day of battle, Robert E. Lee gathers together the last of his reserves and throws it at the weakest spot of the Union line. And this is the very famous Pickett's Charge. You know, General Pickett leads this regiment up to the top. And usually it takes casualties of around 20 to 30 to 40% to break a charge of infantry. Pickett loses more than 70% of his men charging up that hill in the face of Union guns and cannons. And he even makes it to the top. Pickett's charge is actually successful. It breaks through the Union line, but it's an unsupported charge. And the handful of soldiers that are alive at the top of that hill, they just have to surrender. Gettysburg is so bloody and so violent and so disastrous. 51,000 men are killed between July 1st and July 3rd. It shatters both armies. One fourth of the U.S. Army is destroyed at Gettysburg. One third of the Confederate Army of Northern Virginia is dead at Gettysburg. Both armies are completely shattered. Lee is just aghast. Lee cannot believe the carnage that's taken place with his beloved army. As his army falls back in pieces from the battlefield at Gettysburg, he can barely speak. He starts to shake uncontrollably. And his subordinates have to figure out how to get their army out of southern Pennsylvania as the shattered Confederate army tumbles to the south. Back in Vicksburg, Pemberton and the Confederate Army of Mississippi is inside the Great Fortress. He hears of the defeat at Gettysburg. And Pemberton realizes if Lee is lost at Gettysburg, that means no relief is coming to Vicksburg. And as you can see from the drawing right over my head, Pemberton issues a letter to Ulysses S. Grant, ready to discuss terms of surrender. He comes down from the battlements. Grant sits on a log, lights a cigar, hands it to Pemberton, and then lights his own. And the two men sitting on the ground work out the surrender of one of the three great armies of the Confederacy. Vicksburg has fallen. And again, I know I keep harping on these Civil War ironies. The two greatest battles of the Civil War. News of these two great Union victories reaches Washington at the same time because both armies are huge American victories and they end on the 4th of July. Lee's army is falling back from Gettysburg, utterly savaged. They're not even in a single body. More often, it's just groups of soldiers who are just trying to get south as best they can. Robert E. Lee knows that if he can get the remains of his army back to Virginia, he might be able to kind of glue it together in some way and replace all the men he has lost. But the Union generals smell blood, and they can repair their army quicker. And the Army of the Potomac begins to surge forward, and they are about to annihilate Lee's entire force, which is basically just scattered across southern Pennsylvania, you know, running as fast as it can. And just as the Army of the Potomac is about to roll forward and crush the Army of Northern Virginia, they get important orders from Washington, D.C., commanding half of the Army of the Potomac to go north, to leave off their pursuit of Lee, and they have to send almost half of their army to New York City. They're like, why are we going to New York City? We're on the verge of winning the war. Because New York has exploded in the draft riots. Between July 13th and 16th of 1683, anger towards the draft explodes across New York City. And New York City had always been really sympathetic to the Confederate cause because they were the people actually moving cotton around the country. Anti-draft riots explode. They plunge the city into violence. Armed gangs take over the city. They began to lynch African Americans. They burn a black orphanage to the ground because they're blaming African Americans for the death and the violence and the cause of the war. Over 120 people die in these week-long riots across New York City, the largest civil disturbance in American history. And it takes soldiers fresh from the battlefield of Gettysburg to suppress the draft riots of New York. The U.S. Navy sails up, you know, the East River, and they, like, point their guns down, like, the streets of New York, and they threaten everyone off the street, or we're just going to open fire and shell downtown New York. It is brutal, but it works. The army quells the riots in New York, but Robert E. Lee escapes to Northern Virginia. The president visits the battlefield at Gettysburg later in the year, in November of 1863. And he doesn't know what to say about this battle where more Americans have died than any other battle in history. He doesn't know what to say. Speeches in those days were generally hour-long affairs. And the story about the Gettysburg Address is that he wrote it on a spare piece of paper or on an envelope on the train from Washington, D.C. to the Gettysburg battlefield. And he stands up and he gets ready to speak. And the photographer in the picture above was getting ready for the camera, but the Gettysburg Address is only 272 words. There it is. And so by the time Lincoln is finished, the photographer realizes that the speech is over. And he takes this picture, not of Abraham Lincoln giving the Gettysburg Address, but of Abraham Lincoln stepping away from the podium. And it's only 272 words, the Gettysburg Address. But it is probably one of the greatest speeches in American history. And it's so great, I'm not even going to attempt to say it here. There's plenty of dramatic readings you can find online. You can read it yourself. It is truly one of the greatest speeches ever given by an American president. It is a reaffirmation of the principles of Thomas Jefferson, of Thomas Paine, of the idea that all men are created equal. Let's return to the map. Here was the Civil War in 1863, at the beginning of 1863, with the South on the edge of victory. Here we are, 11 months later, everything has completely turned. One of the great Confederate armies has been eliminated. A second of the greatest of the Confederate armies has been utterly smashed and beaten and is fleeing back to Northern Virginia. By the end of 1863 and the beginning of 1864, the South is on the edge of defeat. This one year has completely turned the war around. And it's not just that the South is being outproduced and outnumbered by the North. The South is also being out-invented by the North. The North is filled with all of these inventors who are carefully inventing new ways to do things. And these include ironclad ships, even more advanced ironclad ships like the monitors with like turrets that can swivel around all metal ships. Observation balloons. The North actually has a balloon corps where they can send up five or six men in one of these hot air balloons, and they have people with spyglasses and binoculars and telegraphs to communicate with the ground. They're not going to be surprised by Lee anymore when they can see, you know, 85 miles in every direction. They have telegraphs. They have armored trains. The Confederate cavalry used to be able to wreak havoc on the Union trains, but it's hard to attack and savage a train when it's basically just a tank on wheels. And one of the things that begins to enter service in large numbers are repeating rifles. Specifically, the Spencer repeating rifle. Now, Spencer himself invents this repeating rifle, and goes to show it to Abraham Lincoln, who is very impressed with it. In fact, Lincoln is so impressed with it, he wants one. So they basically make Abraham Lincoln one of these special repeating rifles. And Abraham Lincoln really loved his rifle. And it's funny that we think of Abraham Lincoln as the great emancipator, the great lawgiver, this man of peace. But he was also a man. And when especially frustrated after a long day of pounding his head against racist Northerners or obstinate Confederates, sometimes he would just take his repeater to the South Lawn of the White House and with whatever senator or diplomat or general he was with, and they would basically just shoot bottles for about an hour. And it's funny to think of Lincoln on the white, in basically his backyard, you know, shooting rifles. And the Spencer repeating rifle was an incredible improvement on the old rifled musket. Because you see, with a Spencer repeating rifle, you could, you know what, I'm not even going to describe it to you. In fact, it's better to show you rather than an attempt to describe the difference. So in the above clip, is a competition between repeating rifles, the Spencer, and later the more advanced Henry rifle, and the old rifled musket that the Confederates are using. So watch carefully to how these two men operate their weapons.
Commence. Fire.
Now the Henry.
Commence firing.
Oh, Henrys are such pretty guns. Incredible. It's just incredible. Now imagine what 50 or 100 men armed with repeating rifles are going to do against a bunch of Confederates who just have the old rifled muskets. And large numbers of these rifles begin to enter Union service in 1863. And here's a photograph of a bunch of Union soldiers, you know, with Henry repeating rifles. And I like this photograph because you can see these guys are showing off their guns. They are always putting their guns front and center. They're making sure that the photographer gets that they've got Henry repeating rifles. And I especially like the look on that guy's face, who's saying, like, why are you pointing your rifle at my face? Because weapon discipline was not strictly enforced. And remember that the two armies of Tennessee were locked in deadlock in the center of the country. Ulysses S. Grant is promoted to be the commander of the entire Army of Tennessee. and he looks at these ridges and mountains and valleys that the Confederate Army of Tennessee has entrenched itself on top of, and he issues a command. He says, you have to break through those mountains. And the Union generals, including one guy named Rosecrans, says, that's going to be incredible. We're going to lose 10,000 men trying to take those mountains and hills. And Grant looks at all of these dug-in Confederate positions and says, no, you'll lose way more than 10,000. But ordered by Grant, and she brings Sherman along, they take command of the Army of the Tennessee, and they launch the Chattanooga Campaign, a series of battles fought between September and November of 1863. And you can see, you know, these battles up against these mountains, Battle of Lookout Mountain, the Battle of Missionary Ridge, the Battle of Chickamauga, the Battle of Chattanooga. It is not a single battle, but rather a bunch of little battles as the Union attacks up the sides of these mountains, it attacks up these ridges. Casualties are absolutely horrifying. And one of the few advantages that the Union soldiers have is this is one of the first times you start seeing entire regiments equipped with repeating rifles. And they lose soldier after soldier after soldier. And Grant is quite correct. It takes upwards of 20, 30,000 bodies to push the Confederates off the top of those mountains. The carnage is incredible, but Grant wins the battle. He is eventually promoted to be the supreme commander of the U.S. military, and he will eventually take control of the Army of the Potomac. However, as the Union armies advance, as they are waging total war on the Confederates, as total war is being waged on the South, it provokes this unexpected response. The poor whites, these people living out in these marginal areas, these are people who they didn't own slaves, they didn't care for slavery, they wouldn't fight for slavery. They find themselves on the receiving end of the North's campaign of total war. You know, those poor white farmers there on the upper left, they're not going to fight for some slave-owning planter. They're not going to fight to defend slavery, but they will fight for their homes. They will fight for their farms. They won't fight for slavery, but they will fight to defend what little they have. As the Union armies start to push south and tear up the Southern nation, the number of soldiers willing to fight for the Confederacy increases. Resistance stiffens as the interior of the Confederacy itself was invaded. And you can see this recruiting poster. You know, before it was all about honor and chivalry. Now, the songs and the recruiting posters that are going around what remains of the Confederacy is, who will care for mother now when this cruel war is over? Because the Union soldiers are coming for your mother. The war has entered a much more brutal stage. And in fact, there's the most famous sniper in the Civil War is a guy called Jack Hinson, Old Jack. And his story completely exemplifies what happens. Old Jack is basically just a poor Appalachian farmer. He's not interested in the slavery. He's not interested in the Confederacy. He basically just wants to hang out in his tiny little part of the world, you know, and farm, you know, and maybe a little bit of tobacco, a little bit of cotton. But he gets swept up in the violence. Union cavalry comes through. They burn his farm. They shoot his horses. They find his two sons hunting deer and assume that they're Confederate bushwhackers, they're Confederate guerrillas. They execute both of his sons. And Old Jack, who had been neutral in the war up until now, picks up his 50 caliber Kentucky long rifle and takes to the woods. And over the next 2.5 years, Old Jack will get over 100 confirmed sniper kills. Over 100 regular soldiers and something upwards of 36 officers. He becomes the deadliest sniper in the Civil War. And he only uses iron sights. And he survives to the end of the war. But this is what's happening to the poor people of the South. They're caught up in this campaign of total war, and they begin to join the Confederate armies. And it's at this point where the Confederacy really stops caring about slavery. Slavery's got nothing to do with the Confederacy from here on out. They are fighting to defend mother and home and hearth. And it's this wave of recruits that allows Robert E. Lee to rebuild the Army of Northern Virginia following the catastrophic defeat at Gettysburg. And what happens is the Union Army of the Tennessee has pushed through the Appalachian Mountains, and it's pushed the Army of Tennessee south. And the Army of Tennessee falls back to the great fortress that they've built of Atlanta. Now, when Grant goes to command the Army of the Potomac, he leaves William Tecumseh Sherman in charge of the Army of the Tennessee. And he pushes through the mountains, and he approaches the great fortress of Atlanta, where the Confederate Army there is commanded by Joe Johnston, that guy who almost got his shoulder blown off in the Peninsular Campaign. And they meet on July 21st, 1864, this terrible battle in and around Atlanta. And Joe Johnston is utterly and completely defeated. The shattered Confederate Army of Tennessee retreats into Alabama, and they get a new general, and the new general decides to lead his army north in an attempt to divert Sherman from attacking the interior of the Confederacy. It is a terrible idea. It's an absolutely awful idea. And the Confederate Army of Tennessee basically breaks up over the winter of 1864. The second great Confederate army has ceased to exist. But during this tremendous battle, during the attack and the evacuation of Atlanta, for some reason, no one knows how the fire got started, but Atlanta erupts into flames. And Sherman will not let his men fight the fires. People are calling out for the soldiers to help them put out burning Atlanta. Sherman refuses. He's like, there's Confederates in this area. I'm not going to ask my men to put down their guns and help you bunch of rebels and traitors put out your city. Let it burn. And Atlanta burns. And this is what the U.S. Army left of Atlanta as they roll into it. Actually, I think that's Columbia, South Carolina. But anyway, Atlanta is left a hollow, shattered pile of ruins. And Sherman looks at Atlanta and says this is what he's going to do to the rest of the South. Sherman takes his army and he strikes towards the coast. In Sherman's march to the sea, he declares, I can make this march and I will make Georgia howl. He splits his army into three huge columns and moves across Georgia, burning, destroying, killing everything in his path. He burns homes. He tears up crops. He shoots cattle. He slaughters hogs. He blows up bridges. He rips up railroads. They burn any building that is not a church. Okay? And he leaves this path of destruction across Georgia, the like of which has never been seen in American history, either before or since. No army has ever done to America what Sherman did to Georgia. And they rip up all these railroads. And in order to make it so that the Confederates can't rebuild their railroads, what the soldiers will do is start a fire and put the rails over the fire to soften the metal. And then basically a bunch of these guys will get a tree and grab the softened rails and wrap the rails around the tree. And these become known as Sherman's neckties. And even to this day, you can go to these kind of sleepy little towns in Georgia, and you can occasionally find in the town square neckties left over from the Civil War. These what's left of Sherman's march across Georgia enshrined in town centers. It's Sherman's necktie. But there's a group of people that are very, very happy to see Sherman rip Georgia apart. The American slaves. As he tears his way across Georgia, he frees tens of thousands of hundreds of thousands of African Americans, and they join the Great March to the Sea, trailing his armies in a great jubilant parade. And Sherman issues Special Order 15, and this is what Sherman says. By the laws of war and orders of the President of the United States, the Negro is free and must be dealt with as such. He cannot be subjected to conscription or forced military service. Domestic servants, blacksmiths, carpenters, and other mechanics will be free to select their own work and residence, but the young and able-bodied Negroes must be encouraged to enlist, to contribute their share towards maintaining their own freedom and securing their rights as citizens of the United States. Sherman hates slavery, and Sherman says, all of the death and destruction that we visit on the South has been earned by the sin of slavery. Sherman, like Grant, is no racist. And Sherman has acquired this really awful reputation for what he did to the South during the March to the Sea and his turn north, the death, the destruction. This is what Sherman says. War is cruelty. There is no use trying to reform it. The crueler it is, the sooner it will be over. And Sherman burns the South. I want to return to our ethical dilemma just a bit. And when I often teach this, a lot of students basically say, yes, Edmund Davis made the right decision. Edmund Davis, the Texan who fought against Texas, the man who turned on his own family and fought for his country against slavery. And a lot of students say, yeah, Edmund Davis made the right call. But I often trick students when I do that, because I know what's coming. It's not just a question of, will you fight for your country against your family? If your family is fighting for a moral evil like slavery, and the country is fighting for the moral good, which is the destruction of slavery, but the government has made the decision that the way to win this war is to conduct total war upon your own home. So the wrinkle in this ethical dilemma is not just, do you fight for your country or for your family? Do you burn your own hometown if the government ordered you to? Would you hang your cousin because the government ordered you to? Your family might be fighting to defend slavery, but the government wants you to visit death and destruction on your own hometown, on your own homes. And Edmund Davis did this. Edmund Davis led his cavalry up and down the coast of Texas. Edmund Davis burned farms around Brownsville. He shot cattle outside Corpus Christi. He hanged his own cousin outside of Beaumont. He led soldiers all the way, you know, from Shreveport to Galveston, burning and killing, tearing things up, and visiting death and destruction and impoverishment on his fellow Texans. Is Edmund Davis still morally correct? 1864 has completely changed the landscape. Two of the three Confederate armies have ceased to exist. Only Robert E. Lee's legendary Army of Northern Virginia remains. By the end of 1864, the South is on the verge of total defeat. The election of 1864 is closer than Lincoln would like. He only wins 55% of the popular vote. But Lincoln is reelected in the Electoral College, and with him, that vice president that he chose in a moment of weakness, Andrew Johnson. Both of them enter the White House, and the decision to get Johnson, made back in the dark days of 1862, 1863, will come to haunt the nation. But in ways we'll explore next time, and I will see you there.